or to pass through an authentication. So you can use fuzzing to test software stability, but also the security or the quality of the software. And all of the fuzzing is done in the point of view of the offender. So your goal is really to crash the program, and you want to crash it, you do what you want for it. And the advantage of fuzzing in comparison of static code analysis or dynamic code analysis is that fuzzing is really, really simple, which means that in 4 hours you can write a fuzzer and find the first bugs. It's very fast because most fuzzer find bugs in 1 minute or maybe 1 hour, but that's very, very fast if you compare to static analysis, which can take many hours. I think it's also efficient because you are sure that you are able to crash a program. Because if you read the source code and you find a strange memory code, it's maybe possible to crash it, but you are not sure and you don't know exactly how to crash it. Whereas with fuzzing, you have already the data to crash the program. And fuzzing can be used on the free software. You consider the target as a black box. So you just send data and you watch the reaction, but you don't need to read the source code. So it's also possible to test closed source software, like Microsoft, all software running on Microsoft Windows. Fuzzy is my program, my further project. So it's a Python library with a lot of tools to create a process, to watch the standard outputs, to watch logs, to watch the memory usage, to watch the CPU usage, etc. But it's also more than 20 fuzzers. One fuzzer is very specific to one target, like GIMP, Clamavé, antivirus, and a lot of similar. There are a lot of different fuzzers. And with Fuzzy, I already found bugs in a lot of software like Clamavé, GIMP, the GNU Libc, but also Python. And the Fuzzy is main target is a command line program on Linux, but you can also test a network server. You can test Firefox, which is a graphical application. The different input vectors, they are the command line, the files, the environment variables, the TCP sockets, UDP sockets, etc. And the probes to watch the software reaction, to watch if the software is still running, if it takes a lot of memory, etc. There is a standard output, the logs, the process exit status, which means an exit code or the process killed by a signal. And the networking is used on the remote servers to test that, to try if the server is still running or not. And there is also an integrated debugger, which is called Python Paratrace. In Fuzzy, I use a proc core systems, which means that each probe has a score, and you do the sum of all probes, and you can also give a write of the probe to say that if you have a lot of false positive, you can use a lower score, a lower write for the probe, a score of minus one or minus 10% is input rejected. 0 is nothing special, and the higher score means simply a crash. In fuzzing, we use three different types of data generation. The first most easy technique is to generate pure random, like the example with Netcat. But this technique only works on a very on software with no QA, with no security, which means also no user or very few users. So we prefer infusing to inject false invalid data. So you can take a JPEG picture or a movie or anything, any file, and you replace some bytes, you invert bits or etc. You can also truncate the file. And this technique is very efficient because all video players crash. And it's also the easiest technique, easiest because the first one doesn't work on a real application. And the second main technique is to generate data using a model, which means that you read the specification of a format, like a PNG format, and you generate valid data, valid respecting the specification. And such tests go deeper in the program because you pass through the first test, which tests the program is the file is valid or not. But the problem with this model is that you need a specification. An example of a fuzzer is a Python fuzzer. So the first step is to list all Python models. The second step is to list all functions. And then you do a random function call with random arguments. So it's very, very stupid, but it works very well. Example of fuzzer in a Fuzzy, they are the Clamavé Antares fuzzer, which already found a critical bug. The bug was on a Microsoft Office document with a single file of 10 kilobytes. You are able to crash a server. There is also the Firefox fuzzer, which means that you can test any embedded content. So a picture, a video, SVG file, anything that you want. There is also many audio-video player fuzzer, like JStream, MPlayer, and VLC. And ImageMagick, which is a library to convert any type of picture from one format to another, but also to modify the picture. I have also fuzzer which targets a library like GetText. GetText is a library to translate English to any language. And I like this fuzzer because it works very fast and it always crashes the program. There is also Poplar. Poplar is a library to display your JPEG, PDF documents, and it's used by Evins on KPDF. And finally, there is also a printf fuzzer. The printf generates random calls to printf, but with valid data and valid format string. So it's a test to make sure that the printf works correctly. And finally, there is a fuzzer specific to one programming language, like the Python one, but also a fuzzer for PHP. With the Python fuzzer, I found something like 10 bugs or maybe 100 bugs. There are a lot of bugs in Python. And the algorithm is, like I said, a random function call with random arguments. An example of Fuzzy. So you just type the name of the fuzzer, it generates a lot of function calls. Here I test Python 2.5.2. It tests each time it tests a different module. And here we have a crash on a local module, which is an invalid memory read from a null address. By default, the fuzzer stops at the first crash, so in 6 seconds, it's already found bugs in Python. And when we have a crash, Fuzzy stores all data in the directory, Here it's a directory Python dash two. We have the project log, which are the all logs of the project, and a subdirectory for each crash. In the directory name, you have already the information about the crash. So first, the module name underscore local, but also the type of the crash here, invalid read from null address. In the directory, you have different files. We play the script to replay the session. Session.log is all logs from death crash, death specific crash. STLayout is a standard output, etc. Here you have the session.log. It repeats the same information, so invalid memory read. And you have also the score of 200%. You can replay the crash with replay.py. It's the same crash with getText. It's very important to replay the crash because you need, for example, to run it in a debugger. If you add dash dash GDB, you are able to replay the crash in GDB. And here you can get more information, for example, the backtrace. You can also read the assembler code. You can dump register, etc. So here it's some invalid read with the RRX register, which is new. And you have also the backtrace using where. So here you have a bug in the local module. We have some information missing because you need to recompile the program with debug symbols. Here it's the generated script to test the local modules. So they are only a random function call. For example, here's a local conf with integers, then with Unicode string, then with boolean, etc. And we test all functions from the module with different arguments to make sure that Python doesn't crash. When you have a crash, then there is a most important point to analyze the crash. So first, the criticality of an error. The denial of service is the most typical type of error, which means that the program crash or the server stops to answer to the clients. To measure the criticality, there are different criteria, like losing data. You are working in a very important file, and if the program crash, you lost all your work. Permanent error means that every time you can, if you quit and restart the program, the error is permanent. And then the difficulty to reproduce the error, which means that, for example, you have to set a specific variable environment, you need a specific language, you need a specific file. So it depends on the error. And the second question is it a bug or a vulnerability? A vulnerability means that you can steal data, so read anywhere in the memory or read anywhere in the file system, or modify files. So write, for example, you can deface a website, or the most interesting point is to inject code. So you can execute your own code. When I send bugs to the editors, there are three different types of answers. The first answer is that we don't care. For example, the getText author just tell me that he want performances, he want getText to be very, very fast, but he don't care to security. The second type of error is to apply patches. So the editor just take my specific crash and fix it, but he doesn't try to test if there is a similar error. And the last type of answer is an editor interested to test Fuzzy or to test similar tools to test software quality. And in my point of view, it reflects the project quality. Because if the project rejects a patch or don't care, it means that the program may crash or has a lower quality. Some ideas to generate new faults that are not implemented yet in Fuzzy. We can use fail memalloc. It generates error in memory allocation. You have to use dev full. It's a specific device. You can read some data from this device, but after 10 bytes, it generates an error. Another idea is the time jumps, which means that you can change the system clock and make sure that the program doesn't crash. You can also send signals, process signals like sig user, sig term, sig fault, or something like that. And also network fuzzers, because most Fuzzy fuzzers are specific to program using files, like GIMP, FlamAV, etc., are all working on files. It's very interesting to test network clients or test network servers. There are different fuzzer libraries, explained later, which are specific to networks. Other idea for new probes. The probes, for example, code coverage can be very useful to make sure that we go deeper and deeper on the program, because we must further only test the first phase of the, how can I say that? It only makes sure that your file validity is correct or not. With code coverage, you can make sure that you are deeper in the program. So for code coverage, you can use JCOV or DynamoRio. There are also memory faults using Valgrind or Purify, because sometimes the program doesn't crash, but if you replay the same session, it will crash because of some memory bugs. Fuzzy is only one library, but there are a lot of other free software fuzzers, like Sully, Pish, and EFS, which are the three most important libraries. But there is also Bunny, Flyer, Scapy. I think Flyer is the most interesting because it uses Valgrind to make sure that you don't have some strange memory errors. But it also used Valgrind for the code coverage. Last year, Samosva presented ZUF. And there is also Spike and Protoss, which are network fuzzers. So while using a Fuzzy instead of another fuzzer, first idea is that Fuzzy is main program, so it's the best. But also that Fuzzy is very good to run it in a world night. It collects data and it doesn't need a human interaction, because you can ask to stop after one crash, but you can also ask to crash after 1,000 bugs or more. And it only keeps the success files, which means the crash files related to a crash. So if the session is not interesting, the files are just deleted. There is also a replay script, so you can make sure that the program still crash, or you can replay the session in a debugger, you can replay it in Valgrind. And there is, and Fuzzy generates crash information. Like in the demo, you have the module name, you have the type of the error. You have also the environment variables. You have a lot of information about the crash, which is very important to detect duplicate crashes. And safety, because Fuzzy is running in a different user. it is running under the Fuse user and not your own user or root user. It's very dangerous to run a fuzzer in a computer because it can delete any file on your computer. It can kill any process. It can write a very stupid data in your files, etc. So it's very important to use a different user. There is other protection like memory protection. The fusing process is limited to 10 megabytes or a little bit more. There is also protection about time, which means that if the process is running more than 60 seconds, it's stopped. So to conclude, Fuse is distributed under the GNU GPL license. It's running on Linux, but you can also use on any POSIX compliant OS like FreeBSD, but also macOS. Or you can also try to run it on Windows, but there is no tool to test a graphical application. There is no tool to catch message boxes. So you may try other fuzzers like Sully. And Fuse is written for Python 2.5, and you have the UL below. So do you have any question? Yes? Yes. The coverage of the program? Yes, the question is how can I know that I tested all specification of the file format? For example, if I test a JPEG file, there are a lot of different chunks. The answer is that I don't know. You have to, it depends of the method. If you inject false invalid data, you will only test the death specific file. So you have to use 10 files or more to test different type of chunks, of file chunks. And if you generate data using a model, you have to implement the world format. So you know that each type of chunks is tested. Yes?
In your experience, what is the most common cause for crashes? And what should developers do to prevent those types of crashes?
The question is the most typical cause of crash. The cause is always the same. You have to validate inputs. It's very common on a web application. You have to validate each field in the form. It's the same in any program. You have to make sure that the image size is, for example, between 10 or 20, but not 1 million or 4 million. And yes, you have to validate the inputs. But the performances, it's not true, because you can add some checks. It's very, very cheap to test that a field is a certain interval. So it doesn't impact the performances. And another code of crash is simply bugs in program. For example, you allocate memory, but you doesn't check that the memory is really allocated. Yes?
I wonder, did you use Fuzzy to first Fuzzy, or do you plan to use Fuzzy to first Fuzzy?
The question is, did I test Fuzzy on Fuzzy? The answer is no.
do you plan to?
I don't plan to test Fuzzy because I know that there are bugs in Fuzzy, but I don't. Yes. But I don't want to test my own further. My goal is to test software like GIMS or other programs. Another question? I tried, but I don't found bugs yet. But there are different further, like sysfuse, which do random system calls. But you have to generate a random system call is doesn't work. You have to write the same structure. Because if the system call is has a very invalid argument, the input are just rejected. But yes, there are further for the Linux kernel, but also for Windows kernel and to FreeBSD kernel, etc. It's very interesting to test the kernel, because if you find a bug in the kernel, you are more the root user, you can do anything you want. Yes? Excuse me? Je n'ai pas entendu, quelqu'un a compris. Mm-hmm. I tested Firefox, but the interaction is very low because I run Firefox with an URL, and then I just send a special key, the F5, to refresh a page. But testing a graphical application is a little bit more complex because you have to script the action. But most of the time, you don't need to test a graphical application because, for example, to test KPDF or events, you don't need to test the graphical application. I use the PDF to text, which is a command line program. And if I found a bug in a PDF to text, I'm sure that events on KPDF will also crash. And for example, for the GIMP, I didn't test the graphical application because there is a command line. It's possible to script GIMP with the command line. And it's similar for most applications on Linux. You can use the command line to test the program. Any other question? The question is about the CPU usage about for fusing. I don't know. It's usually high, but it depends on the program. For example, if a program takes 10 seconds to open the file, sometimes the CPU usage is very low. But if you find a denial of service, a crash, the CPU usage can be 100%. Other question? Yes?
What will be the future of the
future? Okay. The future of the future. Here are some ideas to find more bugs. I'm very interested in network further because it's a little bit more funny to test a program in a remote position. But there are a lot of ideas. You can do anything you want with a further. The idea is to find new ways to test a program. For example, if you test ImageMagick or Firefox, you can test the JPEG file format. But it's not very interesting because it's already done by other people. The idea is to test rare format like SVG or some video file format. So I don't have a static plan for the future. But there are a lot of ideas to go further. Other question? Yes?
Why did you write it actually? Were you not happy with the existing fuzzers or?
Why did I watch Fuzzy? I'm a hacker. I like programming. And it was easier for me to write a Fuzzer with my own code, because for other frameworks you have to learn how to write a Fuzzer. And also main fuzzers of this list are targets Windows on graphical application or network application, but I prefer Linux command line programs. Each fuzzer has a typical target, like Fuzzy is Windows target, closed source programs. Protoss is more to network programs, and Fuzzy is more for Linux command line programs. Yes?
Are there any relation between the other program you wrote, who is interested in Python, and Fuzzy?
Is your question about Ashwar? Yes, I wrote the question is, is it a relation between Fuzzy and Ashwar? I wrote Ashwar, it's a generic library to parse file format. I used Ashwar to test RPM, RPR program, because you have to recompute the checksum. And in each RPM, you have to, the checksum has a different position. So I use already Ashwar to test Fuzzy. Other question? Yes?
Is it easy to implement a new fuzzer to test, for example, my own application?
The question is it easy to write a new fuzzer? For me, it takes 1 hour to write a new fuzzer, but most of the time, the fuzzer is very easy to implement, but then you have to analyze the crash, and and that's a typical point, the analyze crash takes more time. And writing a fuzzer depends of the interaction. For example, for GIMP, you have to write a script. For Clamavé, you have to generate files and run a specific program, which is very easy. So it depends of the target and how you run the program. But usually it takes less than 1 day to write a new fuzzer. It's very fast. But the problem today is that nobody cares about the security. Other question? So thank you.